This video has major spoilers, but only for people who have never played Fallout 4 before. These spoilers appear at the very beginning of the game, so if you haven't played Fallout 4 and you don't want the surprise spoiled for you, please turn back now. This video is not about the sole survivor. No, this video is about Nate and Nora. Great moments of tragedy tend to change people. If a courier gets shot in the head, he's a different man from then on out. When a child loses his father, he can become an entirely different person in his quest to find the man. And when a person loses a spouse and child, they can turn into someone they don't recognize. We as players can control the sole survivor to make his or her decisions. But the sole survivor and his or her spouse lived for many years before we even meet them as either Nate or Nora. So what are their stories? What major life decisions did they make before we met them? Well, we have a very brief but precious moment of time to get to know our spouse before the bombs drop in 2077. When we arrive at the House of Tomorrow, we can walk around and either Nate or Nora will interact with objects in their home. Oftentimes, they say the same things.
We really need to get those vacation photos developed.
We really need to get those vacation photos developed.
But sometimes they have very different things to say. For example, if Nora sees her husband's military uniform in the closet, she says,
I'm so proud of him.
But when Nate sees his uniform,
war never changes. Got that right.
This gives us the impression that he may have seen some horrible things during his time in the military. Indeed, when we first start playing the game, we're greeted by a cinematic narrated by Nate. This intro movie sets us up for the plot of the game, but it also gives us some of his personal family history. We learned that Nate's great-great-grandfather served in the United States military, that he was deployed during World War II, and he had a wife and child back home waiting for him. We get to see Nate's great-great-grandmother and his great-grandfather as a child. Over 130 years later, Nate, following in the footsteps of his great-great-grandfather, served in the military, waiting for the moment when he could go back home to his wife and to his son whom he'd never seen. Like his grandfather, his wish was granted, not by dropping bombs on Hiroshima or Nagasaki, but by defeating the communist Chinese in Anchorage. When we meet Nate in 2077, he's back home, getting ready for the next phase of his life. But he's a man who's formed his opinion on war through firsthand experiences, which is why the first words he says when we meet him are,
war never changes.
You're gonna knock him dead at the Veterans Hall tonight, hun.
You think?
He's now a veteran, and we just learned from his wife Nora that he's scheduled to make a presentation at some sort of Veterans Hall. He's nervous about it.
Do I look nervous? I look nervous, don't I?
But Nora does her best to soothe his nerves.
Nervous? Don't be. Everyone's gonna love the speech.
Despite what appears to be his disillusion with war, Nate and his wife Nora appear to both be patriotic Americans.
Good old USA.
Good old US of A.
And Nate has a silly sense of humor, and even at his age, he's fond of a good old comic book.
Grognak the Barbarian and the Jungle of the Bat Babies. My favorite.
Comic books which his wife Nora thinks are just plain silly.
Grognak the Barbarian and the Jungle of the Bat Babies.
They're both smokers.
Now who left those here?
Which I suppose is not to be unexpected. This is, after all, the Fallout universe. Everyone smokes in the Fallout universe. And they had a dog that somehow went missing.
Never gonna find that dog.
Unlike her husband, Nora never served in the United States military. Instead, she went to college and got her law degree. We find it in a frame proudly on display in the family's living room. A
lot of late nights, but it was worth it.
She graduated from the Suffolk County School of Law in Boston, Massachusetts. And Nate is proud of his wife.
I'm so proud of her.
I noticed something I had never noticed before. When the Vault-Tec salesman arrives at the House of Tomorrow, we have the opportunity to outright refuse to sign up for a vault. If we do while playing Nate...
Come on, hon. It's just a little paperwork. Let him fill it out, and it's done.
I said no.
And I'm saying yes. So there.
Let's get to it.
Nora puts her foot down, and Nate gets really annoyed. However, if we play Nora...
Come on, hon. It's just a little paperwork. Let him fill it out, and it's done.
I think you forgot what no means.
Fine. I'll do it myself. Stubborn.
Let's get to it.
Nate fills out her registration form himself. This means if we choose this option, the sole survivor's special stats were filled out by her spouse, not by herself. I'm not sure what this means, but I think it's really interesting and kind of endearing. It kind of means that if you play a female sole survivor, you're still carrying something from your husband with you wherever you go. We also learned something slightly scandalous. It seems like this young couple enjoys making love out in the open. When Nora mentions going to the park after breakfast...
Listen, after breakfast, I was thinking we could head to the park for a bit. Weather should hold up.
Nate alludes to this.
Will it be like that night in the park a year ago?
But Nora doesn't beat around the bush.
Oh, right. The park. With you. Because I want to get pregnant again.
So it sounds like baby Sean was conceived in a park. I wonder if this romantic escapade with his wife happened when he came back from the military, in which case that means he would have been here with his wife at least for 9 months, or if this happened when he was on leave. Nora then was pregnant without him for 9 months, possibly gave birth without him even being there, until he finally came home to meet his son. Whether intentional or by accident, Nate and Nora foreshadow the future using the blocks they stacked in their son's room. When we take a look at them, we see the letters spell ICBMS, plural, more than one. As we know, it's after this moment that everything changes. While they were having this brief conversation, the bombs dropped, and their world was changed forever. But this isn't the end to their story, because Bethesda originally intended to have a private family terminal in the House of Tomorrow with a number of diary entries and family reminders about Nate and Nora. Ultimately, they cut this from the game. And I'm just conjecturing here, but I think they likely cut it from the game because having such a detailed backstory for the sole survivor might have interfered with the player's ability to roleplay. However, I don't think that needs to be true. We take the reins of the sole survivor after the sole survivor becomes a completely different person. They've suffered such a traumatic event that something clicks, something snaps. Kind of like a courier being shot in the head, the sole survivor is forced to become a person that he or she would have never otherwise become. And that's the person whose story we get to tell.
Time for a whole new life.
For whatever reason, Nate and Nora's history was cut from the game, but there are mods that restore this history. If you're interested, I link to one of them in the description below. All this mod does is restore the family terminal that was to exist in their home. Heading inside the House of Tomorrow, we can access the terminal where we find Mom's files and Dad's files. Checking out Nate's files, we see that he has two entries. One is the early outline of his speech at the Veterans Hall. And we see that his speech is much like the narration that he gave for the intro video to Fallout 4. War. War is hell. Back when my great-great-grandfather was in the army, the US ended World War II by dropping atomic bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We've come so far since then, haven't we? Technology has given us domestic robots, fusion-powered cars, portable computers, but we're fooling ourselves. Today, in 2077, we're on the brink of total war. What good are high-tech toys now? They can help us escape, but we can't escape the violence in our hearts. War is hell, and if we don't change our ways, we're all going to burn. Note: too weak, too bleak. Focus on family and future. Sounds like the speech he would have given at the Veterans Hall would have been a bit different, but it still reveals a lot about the way Nate thought about the political situation going on in America in 2077. He, like many at the time, could foresee the looming nuclear apocalypse. Even though he encourages the people of that time to change their ways, he never tells us how. But of course, that is the difficult part. In the next one, we see his personal calendar on Saturday, the day his world changed. His speech at the Veterans Hall was going to be at 8 p.m. You'd think someone who's been shot at on a battlefield could handle a bunch of grizzled vets, but I'm nervous as hell. Picturing them in their underwear is not an option. Side note, Game 4 of the World Series is being played in the city this afternoon, and Boston's primed to win for the first time in forever. I would kill for tickets. Nate sure is a big baseball fan. One of his optional responses to Nora when she suggests going to the park is to say no because of baseball.
And miss the World Series? Not gonna happen.
Next, we can see what his plans were for the following week. On Tuesday, October 26th, he was going to have drinks with Fox Company at 7 p.m. Go 108th! It's here that we learn that he served with the Fox Company, 108th Battalion. Probability of us getting drunk and singing the Snows of Anchorage five times, 110%. On Thursday, October 28th, date night, 8 p.m. Nate and Nora had a healthy marriage, I think. He seems so excited for date night. He says Concord's getting a little tired, thinking we'll head to Boston. Italian? Please, please, Nate, don't take her to Joe's Spuckies. Joe's Spuckies is not Italian. It may be an Italian sub, but I hope he was going to take her someplace a little more fancy. And his final plans for the week, Sunday, October 31st, Halloween all day. We're still torn on Sean's costume, but I think we've got it narrowed down to two. I say cop, but my better half thinks a tiny devil would be adorable. She's got a point. Is this an example of mother's intuition? Did Nora see something about her young son that Nate didn't? Is this foreshadowing? Perhaps I'm overthinking it. Figure we'll take him trick-or-treating around 6 o'clock, before it gets too dark, and that'll get me home in time to stop that Rosa kid from TPing the house. This alludes to another terminal that was cut from the game, involving one of the neighbors named Rosa. By now, we've seen many references to this Veterans Hall. We see many ruins 200 years after the apocalypse. Could this Veterans Hall still exist? If it does, maybe we could find some trace of pre-war Nate. Well, the closest we get is when we head to the Cambridge area. Here we find Fraternal Post 115. Heading through the front door, we see the building completely ruined. A terminal hangs out of a broken room on the second floor, and we see human heads hanging from chains. That would be evidence of raiders, but we also see super mutant meat bags. This place must have been infested by an assortment of enemies over the years. Turning right and going down the hallway, we see skeletons through a hole in the wall that looks like a bathroom. And one of the skeletons wears a military uniform, which makes a lot of sense. This is a fraternal post. The door at the end here is locked with a novice lock. Picking it, we can creep on through. We find ourselves in a large chamber lit with firelight from a barrel. And standing by a large chest is one super mutant named Deadeye. But at this level, he was easy work. Heading into the large room, we need to be careful of the landmines. And then up on the podium, we can turn off the radio that Deadeye was listening to before looting his corpse. He just has some caps. We see two more pre-war skeletons tucked in a corner, both wearing military uniforms. Heading back onto the platform, we find a copy of Guns and Bullets on the podium. Little guns for little ladies. Ballistic weapons permanently do 5% critical damage. And here we see a microphone. If the male soul survivor activates it, he says,
"War. War never changes."
Much like he would have at the beginning of the speech he never gave. But the female soul survivor says the same thing. If an explosion has somehow knocked over the microphone, even if we find it lying on the ground, the voice trigger still works.
War. War never changes.
In the middle of this room is a barrel of fire, next to a whole bunch of loot. We can loot two ammo boxes, a duffel bag, and an end-of-dungeon steamer trunk. We see a big shopping cart filled with gore, and quite an assortment of teddy bears. These super mutants enjoy a strange combination, gore and teddy bears. We see an exit door to the north, but before we leave, let's see if we can find any trace of Nate. In the bathroom, we find many skeletons, some over the toilet, some crouched against the wall. Heading out of the bathroom through a hole in the wall, we can go across to a storage room on the other side. There's not much in here but a Nuka-Cola Quantum we find under some rubble. Out a hole in this wall, we see another skeleton pinned beneath a floor that collapsed. This fraternal post must have been filled with veterans the very moment the bombs dropped, killing so many of them. With this explored, we can unlock the door to the exit. It's locked with a novice lock. This brings us to a back staircase which leads up, or the door that leads out. Underneath the stairs, we see a grisly scene of meat bags dangling from the walls, shopping carts filled with gore and viscera, and a hole in the wall that leads to the next bathroom with even more skeletons of military servicemen. Back around and up the stairs, this leads us to the second floor. Through a hole in the wall to the left, we find one storage room with an armor workbench inside, but not much else. Heading out the door to the balcony, which we can follow to the end, we can then turn left or right, turning left and going around the corner, we can disarm some tin can chimes, which leads us to another hallway with even more teddy bears atop big beds of gore. These super mutants were even playing with the teddy bears. We see a rattle in a bottle next to one. This Institute FEV has really done a number to the minds of these people. In one room, we find an office with a bottle of bourbon, of course, and a skeleton. In the next one, we just find a gore bag with a blasted out terminal, but we can go through a broken wall that leads to another broken office, which leads back out to the balcony. This office's door was locked with a novice lock. We can go ahead and unlock that. Continuing down the hallway and turning right leads us back out to the balcony again, which we can reach after disarming another tin can chime. Heading through to explore the blasted out offices, we find two desks with broken terminals and one stash of caps beneath one, and that leaves everything here explored except for the only intact office room at the very end of the hallway. Here in the southwestern corner of the room, we find a novice locked floor safe. This just has some ammunition inside, and this office room has the only working terminal, locked with a novice lock. This is the executive terminal. After hacking the terminal, we find an option to unlock the safe, turn on the turret, or we can read two notes. The first is a speech memo. "We are overjoyed to have such a decorated war hero like Nate giving a speech in Concord. We should try to get him down here too. It always brings in people and funding." So Nate was a decorated war hero. What did he do during battle to achieve such commendation? In the next note, we see a schedule of events. In September, the Fraternal Post was having a Medal of Honor scholarship ceremony. In November, they were giving presentations on the history of Mr. Gutsy. I would love to have attended that. In December, they were doing an orphan food drive. And in January of the following year, they would have done some New Year bingo. Before we leave, we can head downstairs, and there was one thing we missed. There's a circuit breaker on the wall behind the podium, where we found the microphone in the Guns and Bullets magazine. If we activate it...
What? Gonna be a good fight!
We get attacked by super mutants who come through the door. This makes the Fraternal Post quite a challenging place to explore at younger levels, and when we're done, we can exit out the back door. We learned an important piece of information about Nate from the terminal here. The Veterans Hall, where he was scheduled to give his presentation, was in Concord. Now, I spent a long time exploring Concord trying to find the location of this Veterans Hall, but we never find it. There's no interior cell, there's no sign pointing us the way. There was a big celebration going on in Concord, which is why we see all of the banners and flags and light posts decorated. They were celebrating Concord's history. This may also coincide with why they hired Nate to give the presentation to begin with. Many of the buildings on the outskirts are ruined residential buildings, so I think the likeliest place for the Veterans Hall is on the main street, right across from the Museum of Freedom. This is where most of the shops and commercial buildings were. And I can see two candidates for the Veterans Hall. Right next to a ruined municipal fusion well, we see one large ruined building. The storefront portion of it is all boarded up, and it's extremely tall, which kind of gives me an apartments vibe. All of the other buildings on this strip are marked. There's a hotel, a bookshop, a diner that sold floats and candy, a hardware store, but there's one final building that is unmarked. It, like all of these buildings, are covered with American flags, but there's no other signage here, and yet it's also on this strip. My bet is that this was likely the Veterans Hall. It's smaller, it's on a commercial street, and it has no signs. But ultimately, we don't know where he was set to give his speech. Now, we learned from exploring the House of Tomorrow that Nora was a lawyer. She had recently graduated from the Suffolk County School of Law with her law degree. I wonder if we can find any trace of her in the ruins. Heading back to the terminal of cut content at the House of Tomorrow, we find Nora's entries under Mom's Files. And she has a few more entries than Nate does. Hers are split between personal and professional. Taking a look at personal, we see holotape reminder. Got to pick a good moment to present it. Special time? After he gets the job? After his speech? Before his speech? Just when we're out having fun as a family? Super Dad deserves super appreciation. Oh, so she had a sweet little surprise for Nate, but we don't know what it was. And we learned that Nate was looking for work. This, I think, gives credence to the idea that he had just recently come back from war, which means then that he likely had just met Sean for the first time. In the next one, Codsworth Service Reminder, the new infant care subroutines are pretty amazing, and I trust Codsworth with Sean implicitly. So why can't he draw my bathwater at anything over 70 degrees? I swear he is doing it on purpose, trying to be funny, but it's getting old. Time to take him in and have some junk rewired, or whatever it is they do. Was Codsworth really trying to pull a joke on Nora? His Mr. Handy Humor subroutines were likely glitched. In the final one on Halloween costume materials list, we see that Nora had pretty much made up her mind. Sean was going to be a little devil, and that was it. She already had the list. Red felt, red ribbon, little red booties, use eyebrow pencil to draw on a little mustache, check Hubris Comics to see if they have a little plastic pitchfork. Yeah, it would have been adorable. In the next section on professional, we see case file notes. The Blanks versus Kelly. Gina shouldn't even have had me review this one. It's a pretty clear non-starter. Two professional fighters go at it in the ring. One of them loses badly and claims the winner cheated. Doesn't say how, and nothing backs up his claim. Seems like a pretty clear case of sore loseritis. Boo-hoo. Pass. So Nora had a legal aide named Gina. Does this mean she had an office set up? Or was she working from home? And how did she run a law practice while giving birth to Sean and taking care of an infant? In the next one, case file notes, Massachusetts versus Silva. I just can't see how the Commonwealth even has a case here. Corsino Silva, 23-year-old Roxbury resident of Cape Verdean descent, charged with the armed robbery of a Slocum's Joe coffee shop. But there's simply no hard evidence. Just the word of Caselli and even her description of the suspect barely matches Cruz. I think this is the one, the case that gets me back into the game. We've got plenty saved so I can take it pro bono. Corsino Cruz is just some poor fool who's being set up as the bad guy because the state needs him to be. The hell with that! He's innocent, and I'm gonna prove it. Time to show Sean how tough his mommy really is. Wow, this tells us so much about Nora's personality. And we understand a little bit more about her practice. She ends by saying that she wants to get back in the game and this case may be the one. This tells me that she took time off during her pregnancy and after Sean's birth to take care of Sean before finding the right time to restart her practice. There is a glitch in here. She refers to the defendant as Corsino Silva at the very beginning, but twice throughout the rest of the article, she refers to him as Corsino Cruz. So was Silva his middle name? Was Cruz his middle name? Maybe it's just a mistake. First, we get a hint of systematic racism here. She describes the defendant as being of Cape Verdean descent. Cape Verde is an island off the coast of Africa, which was ruled by Portugal until the year 1975. The official language of Cape Verde is Portuguese, and 71% of its inhabitants are multiracial. The next biggest ethnic group is black at 28%. Only 1% of the people of Cape Verde are white. So I'm guessing that by mentioning his Cape Verdean descent, Nora was saying that the state of Massachusetts was singling him out because of his ethnicity. The state must have not been able to find the real culprit of the armed robbery, and so in order to solve the case, they were using Corsino as a scapegoat. And we learned that Nate and Nora had a sizable savings account. If she could take on a case of this magnitude pro bono, for free, with a husband who does not even have a job yet, means that they must have a lot saved up. Which means that the military pays well, because Nora just graduated from law school and got pregnant with Sean. She's been out of work for quite some time due to the birth and taking care of the infant. The only thing that can account for them having enough money for her to take this case for free is that the US military must pay their servicemen, well, in the Fallout universe. And we learned that her motivations for becoming a lawyer were not just to enrich herself to line her pocket. She did so for principled reasons. It seems like she chose her clients very carefully. She didn't want to take the lawsuit brought on by the boxer who was just upset that he lost a boxing match, because that would have been an abuse of the legal system. Instead, she was really excited about taking on the case of Corsino Cruz. Here, she could really see justice being done. She's a principled character. But what about her law school? Can we find it? Well, the closest I was able to find is the campus law offices in Cambridge. Now, her diploma said that she graduated from the Suffolk County Law School. Suffolk County included the greater Boston area. The problem is that Cambridge is not in Suffolk County. Cambridge is in Middlesex County, even though it is part of the Boston metropolitan area. This is the only law school we find in the game. However, I doubt that it's the one where Nora graduated. It likely was part of Harvard, or whatever school of greater learning was here in the Fallout universe. But that means that we don't have any physical trace of Nora in the ruins of Boston. All we have are the cut terminal entries from her own home. I can see why Bethesda chose to cut those terminal entries, because it paints very clear personalities of both of these characters. Nate is a war hero who loved his country, was likely proud of the time he spent with Fox Company, but had become disillusioned with war. Nora is a principled lawyer who seeks to fight injustice, not participate in it. This could potentially be a problem for someone who wanted to roleplay an evil character. I think that's why Bethesda cut these terminal entries. The story of who they were is hard to piece together. We find so few traces. But the story of what happened to them is clear. They suffered in a way that every parent hopes they never will. Their child was stolen. And no matter how we look at that event, we can't deny that they were robbed. They were robbed of something they were both looking forward to raising their child, and to seeing that baby take his first steps, throw his first baseball, ride his first bike.
Can't wait to teach him to ride this.
Glove's a little big now, but Sean will grow into it.
To think, one day he's gonna learn how to drive.
Wonder what Sean will grow up to be.
The little boy that Nora gave birth to, that she put her entire career on pause to bring into this world. The little boy that Nate met for the first time the day he arrived back from serving his country. They never saw him as a toddler, as a boy, as a teenager. All of the things young parents look forward to experiencing, gone in a flash. Nate and Nora were different people with different passions, different jobs, but the evidence is clear that they loved each other desperately. That's why I think that on top of everything, the nuclear apocalypse having their son taken, to then watch the person they love more than anyone on this earth being murdered right before their eyes.
I'm not giving you son!
Is reason enough for the sole survivor to snap, to turn into someone whom he or she would have never otherwise become, to become someone whose story you can tell. They were good parents, and they loved their child, which is why whomever we choose to be the sole survivor, their last words to each other are,
I'll find who did this.
And I'll get Sean back. I promise.
Who do you think can better survive the apocalypse? A decorated war hero or a tough, stubborn lawyer? Who did you choose to go in search for young Sean? And what did you turn your soul survivor into? Let me know your thoughts in the comments section below. I publish a new Fallout video 6 days a week on a wide range of topics spanning all of the games. I've got a new shirt in the shop this week, folks. Thanks, killer. That's right, it's everyone's favorite psychopath from Fallout 4, Pikmin, with his handwritten note on the front and a portrait of the man painting one of his masterpieces on the back. You can find a link in the description, or you can click here. If you like what I do and you want to support me in a more personal way, consider becoming one of my patrons on Patreon. But more than anything, I'm just so glad you're here watching this video with me today. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you tomorrow morning, bright and early, with a brand new video.